Deer Hunter takes most of our practice, I think, also in time-wise and also financially. We live off Deer Hunter mostly.
What does really cartopology means for architects? This is very important for us to understand, since we are more or less all architects. Although, I mean, we do many different things, but in the end, we are supposed to talk about buildings, but actually you don't talk about buildings, or at least not majorly talk about buildings, but you do something else. And it is very nice that, for instance, you have this Wikipedia definition about cartopology that is an academic and artistic discipline that aims to combine anthropological methods with cartographic ways to translate experiences and insights of architectural spaces into maps. And it's a pretty recent item, right? I mean, were you surprised to find yourself embedded into the Wikipedia corpus?
Well, we weren't surprised, as we asked our intern to do it. So so we weren't surprised at all, but we were. It was a complete process to be able to get yourself, or cartopology in this case, on Wikipedia. It's not so easy. It doesn't really make a difference, because for academics, Wikipedia is not something you refer to. But even still, it's kind of cool that you are on Wikipedia, and great professors are there as well. So are represented by Wikipedia. So that was a great joke. And what is even cooler is that you see that the last edit is on the 5th of October. So it's not only us doing it anymore, because somebody else modified the page. We have no idea who it was. But that's cool that it starts living, that people are really dealing with it somehow. And that's something that we enjoy, that it becomes something broader than only the two of us.
And what also is very well, it helps us ourselves also, I think, because in the beginning, indeed, we were hesitant to call the thing we are doing cartopology, and also to convince, for example, civil servants or aldermen of this term, because we just invented it ourselves. And it's much easier also now to really believe in what we are doing, and that it's somehow substantial. So in a way, we trick ourselves with it.
Yeah, but it is fun, since actually, as you wrote, this encyclopedia item, which is, you know, Wikipedia item in the end is an encyclopedia. So you actually behave in an encyclopedic way. So this has affinities with our project in the end. We think that encyclopedia still makes sense, at least from a critical point of view, that just against Google algorithm, so that you simply make a query online and it seems that Google provides you a solution, but it's not like that. I mean, knowledge is something you should build. And so this is a responsibility that you undertake. And so I completely agree with your struggle for having your disciplinary statement, having, you know, being recorded at least into the Wikipedia encyclopedia database. So it is very, I mean, now, actually cartopology is critical, if I'm not wrong. So for instance, when I see this picture here, it seems that you really want to start with saying something that is kind of critical towards, you know, the way architecture is made usually, right?
Yeah, and it's true, it is somehow critical but I think in a positive way, and that's also why I use that picture, because it's exaggerated. Architects don't work like that anymore. And even if they were working like that, I think we have to have an enormous amount of respect of how they were making their plans, laying on them at the same time. But I use that picture also often with students, just to show how much we are focused on the plan, on the map, on what we draw. Nobody is watching or is looking outside here in that picture. We're all looking at the representation of, instead of really looking at what is actually happening in and around the buildings, the areas that we're developing. How are we as architects, but broader as spatial thinkers, also urbanists, how responsible are we for our daily life reality, for how we live, how we perceive space, how we use it, our daily habits, our routines, our rituals? They all take place in a place, let's say. They all are somewhere, and that somewhere is mostly designed by architects or by spatial planners. So we should be much more aware of the places that we design and also of the places that we modify. If we decide we want to demolish or restore or renovate or build a new building, we should know what was at that place before we modify it. And that's something that's the critique, I believe, that within architecture, let's say the offices, but also the education, and also within municipalities, we don't have enough knowledge of the everyday reality. And that is, I think, very important. And that is what cartopology really tries to do. Exactly, that's a very beautiful example of a map of Maastricht, which shows very beautifully the scale on which architects and mostly urbanists like to work. And again, it's not so black and white, but this kind of maps are the maps on which we base decision upon whether we are going to demolish or do the project or not and how. And actually what you see on these maps are squares and circles, and if you're lucky a triangle, but that's it, right? And of course we zoom in and we have details, etc. But to have the overview, which is also necessary, we mostly look at these kind of plans. And cartopology wants to add intimacy to it, locality to it, performativity.
Maybe it is nice to introduce the audience about which are the elements that are the ones that to which, you know, cartopological maps are made, because it's very nice for us when we discovered your practice that you basically introduced elements of mapping that were somehow forgotten since the 17th century. For instance, like sea monsters or other kind of allegories, which are not very common to the kind of mapping techniques that were provided after the Enlightenment period. So, I mean, would you provide us some kind of key elements of you know, cartopological maps?
But besides that, there's a lot to say wrong things to say about these kinds of maps. I really look into them in a way that I compare them often with Google Maps, for instance, because those maps, if you, well, this is a part of Portugal, or what we would call Portugal today at least, and North Africa, and the amount of detail that is put in the coastline, if you compare the amount of detail that is put in the sea monster, you could wonder, or you could ask yourself, what was actually important here to draw? As a drawer and as a craftsman and or woman in that, drawing that sea monster takes an enormous amount of time. Well, however, the coastline, which you would think is the most important to navigate, would be as detailed as possible, but it's the opposite here. Also, for instance, the size of the monster, of the sea monster, is extremely exaggerated somehow. And they saw strange creatures doing their trips, and it was very dangerous, and they were very afraid doing it, but they never saw a creature that big that you could have your ship on it, or that you could prey on it somehow. They never did that somehow, and that wasn't really what they wanted to say somehow, but what they wanted, it says something about the culture of that time and about how sailing was dangerous and how difficult it was, and about the fears of not coming home again. That sort of things is captured in that sea monster.
Yeah, it's true, because with modern sciences, it seems we erased monstrosities. It seems that everything is so reassuring. So people is very relaxed. When they look at maps, it seems like they only look for confirmation of scientific knowledge, but they're not, I mean, the kind of way cartopology attempts to reintroduce actually these old monstrosities, it seems you want to really provide people with another perspective on the world, which is not that you know, kind of relaxing, but it's more also kind of challenging, right?
I think cartopology relates very much to a time where the distinction between science and art and craft wasn't so so present as it is now, and that you could have a sea monster on a very geographically correct map, for instance, that was normal. That's also different. If I'm showing my maps in a time where that's not normal, that's different than seeing a sea monster in that time on a map, let's say. So I think that's why there's a lot of references in that period, let's say.
And Marlies, to this extent, would you explain a bit about logistics, about what is the cartopologist logistics? Isn't it? You really live inside this container, right?
Yes. Well, not at the moment. At the moment, we are luckily on site in Barcelona, which is cool, for 2 months in an Airbnb. But I think around 6 months a year, more or less, at least for the last years, maybe 2021 will be less because of the pandemic. But we are in the container, yes. It's 12 square meters. It's way too small, especially with two, if you work and live together. But we really want to be on site, and I think it's very radical. But if you want to make maps of trying to understand, and maybe if I want to use the word appropriated, you have to be radical. You have to take those steps to fully understand. We could, for instance, instead of a container, we could also have a caravan on wheels, but that would be much easier. Here, but we don't want to be mobile. That's not how we want to be. Like, oh, it's getting cold, or it's getting complicated, or I'm so sick of this place, so let's go home for a weekend. That's not gonna happen. So we have to stick there, and it's through those bad but also good experiences that we are able to map and to understand the place and say things about it, I think, more profoundly in a way. And that is for us very very valuable. I have to say that I don't know if we're not going to stay in that container our whole life, and also our practice evolves, luckily, but that radicality is something that I think you see in a lot of map makers, referring to Humboldt. His trip was much more and way more radical than us sitting in a hip tiny house in the middle of Amsterdam.
So it is nice to look into the history of geography and to cartography and to see whether there was someone that somehow tried, you know, to undertake such kind of, at least to, you know, to kind of develop cartography in a different way. So these two pictures somehow can be interesting, right? Because it seems that maybe Alexander Humboldt tried, you know, to make at least another kind of cartography than the one that we are commonly somehow related to. And so it is nice that, I mean, we portray these two pictures, which are similar, but not identical. No, because it's important for the audience to understand that.
The difference,
The one on the left is the one that we added as Funes editors. And this is the one that Remy and Marlies, suggested. Why? I mean, why didn't you accept this one? This is the point.
Yeah, well, I think the left one is much less cartopological than the right one. Although the left one is very much added by what I would call then real academics, properly referred, and the references to it. I'm a little bit more free-floating in that area. But what I do really, where the difference is that cartopology tries to show that that you need multiple informations and insights of one location. It is not a tool in which you represent a place, but as I said, it is a tool to work with and to understand a place. So it's not something that you made and then that's it. It's something that you work with, that helps you to understand, that helps you to investigate, to research. And the biggest difference is, as you can see, that the columns on the left and on the right. And Alexander von Humboldt, so it's a volcano in South America, and he let's explain it from the beginning. So he went to the volcano. He went on expedition there, and he climbed the volcano. Because besides the columns, also in the middle, the drawing in the middle, you also have two separations. You have on the left side, you have the atmospheric drawing, where he really shows the volcano in all its beauty, let's say, and also in its steepness. And even though it was a steep mountain, it wasn't that steep. And I can imagine that Humboldt had some kind of ego, so he made it steeper, but also it was a very difficult journey. There weren't oxygen masks. So he made it look, it's also a little bit related to the time of this map, but he made it look more dramatically than it actually was. So there you see that his own personal experience of that volcano is also added. On the right side, you see all teeny tiny lines, and actually these are words that represent or that name plants that he found on the mountain. And by localizing them in the section, he could also say that one plant, he found more of it or a different version of it on a different height, let's say. And on the left and on the right, you see columns with super exact information where he used instruments to measure temperature, to measure humidity, to measure all that type of things. And combining all those different types of information helped him to prove or to believe that biodiversity is not only something that differs horizontally, but also vertically, let's say. And when you look at that map, you almost want to put like a horizontal line between the columns on the left and on the right to see which temperature, which plant was it, and was I then in the snow or in the rocks on the left side on the atmospheric drawing. So you really use that map at one point. You really work with it. And at the same time, at least I think personally, it's a very beautiful drawing or map that you could also hang on the wall. So having that autonomous value and at the same time being an almost an academic or a scientific document, the combination of both, I'm very jealous of that. I hope that one day in my life I will be able to make such a map with such an impact somehow.
I would say that there are other authors or that were for sure not cartopologists, like Jefferson, right? Because Jefferson planned all the United States without even being there, because the grid was this kind of device that allowed him to plan from scratch. And then the problem was that in the end he had to correct the grid, because he planned this grid on a tabula rasa, but on a perfect plane, on a table, but actually the world is not like that, it's a sphere. So the problem is that in the end there were some correction that were done in order to provide this green a kind of a continuity. And so there are these strange places, these strange towns in the middle of the United States. And for instance, there is this very interesting one that is called Correctionville. It is basically where the grid doesn't work, and so the town is just converging, and something doesn't work. So yeah.
And you know what's funny, because we talked about it yesterday, and I looked it up on Wikipedia again. I'm not a full hardcore academic, so I'm allowed to do so. And what was interesting is that it's almost ignored, that fact. It's about how many inhabitants it has and that kind of stuff, but not the fact that it's some sort of to indicate a mistake on a plan, let's say. And I think cartopology is the opposite. Instead of, like architects do as well, impose how the world or more specifically a town or a neighborhood or a square should look like, cartopology tries to map how it really is perceived. So it is the other way around somehow. And in that way, instead of being a very powerful document, we see the map more as a research instrument, as a tool to understand for others as well as for ourselves while we're doing our research. And drawing plays an important role in that. But, sometimes you have, because mostly we work for municipalities or public institutions, they ask often how many people did you speak and there's or that you spoke with. And there are a couple of there are a lot of people that come to the container, and mostly the people that come to the container really with a prepared like list of all the things that they want to say are the less valuable to us, because then you know, or then somebody is saying what he thinks about this and about the area, and what we are really looking at after is how they do an area, how they live there. And that's and it's the same with the sea monsters. It's the hidden knowledge. It's the things that we don't say anymore, the things that are so everyday, so ordinary that we are after, because even if it's something that we do every day, or even if it's a reality that we don't see the added value of sharing, it is very specific, right? If I take my coffee every day at the same place, or if I'm having my Zoom, also here, we're only here 2 months, I'm always sitting here to Zoom. That's quite special, right? And that's quite specific. But not special, it's specific, it's quite detailed. And that is so that are the things that we want to add, that are the things that we want to map, that are the things that make a place the place that it is. And that is why we think it's important to be there day and night. Another thing what is important is that when we are in the container, and it's quite contradictory with what I just said, we're also not on the location. In the sense that the moment that you step in the container, we are at home, and at home has been on 20 locations the last couple of years, that it is very much our place, and that helps us to have to abstract, to take a step back, and to reflect on what we experience and what we are mapping. And at the same time, being very close by to go outside again and check something again. Zooming in, being there, being part of the local experience, and at the same time being in the container in front of my drawing, taking only one step but one step back, and having that being able to abstract, and also the drawing and mapping forces you to scale, so to look on another scale and to do something with proportions. That combination constantly helps you to reflect and to be critical and to think about what is happening around you. So it's outside, inside, it's zooming in, zooming out, being part of, taking distance, that is really part of you have to do that a couple of times to make a cartographical map, or at least that's how our practice works.
My question concerns the impact of your research, because I think that you've shown that your research is a really design-driven research. This is, for me, very clear that your medium is drawing, and then you also trying to develop a new kind of performativity of drawing. But for me also as philosopher and a researcher, it's really important to understand the impact of your work. And you spoke in this presentation really a lot also about the relationship with your clients or with the students. And I think this could be really, for me also, interesting to know much more about this relationship, maybe in the form of a publication, or maybe in a kind of documentation, maybe in a kind of video, in which is really clear your impact. Because I think this is a very important point also, for example, regarding Humboldt. We have two different levels. We have the one of the medium, and of course the Humboldt's drawings are very important also as a kind of new diagrammatic medium and language. But in the other way, on the other level, we have of course also the impact of these works and of his work on society, and also really in general on visual culture. And we know that these drawings were really important in order to find new language also in the visualization. And I think it could be very important to document the second phase of your work, not just the work on locality, and then really agree also with your way with your way of relating to the environment and to locality. But I think it could be very important also to give a voice to the other part of the people.
I agree with what you say, that following the map doesn't stop at once it's out of our hands. Maybe then it only starts or another phase starts, and that's definitely something to take in account, but it's something that is very, especially with clients as municipalities and so on, it's not easy to...
Even to trace it.
But for instance, we are sometimes asked in artistic institutions to hang up our drawings, and then they want the maps. Well, then I would call them drawings, because they don't want the text on them. They want the original drawing. And clients often ask the text, a summary of it, and not the drawing in a way. So there you see that there's a lot to happen to make it an integrated document, where it's clearly that you need all the layers somehow. So there it gets documented a little bit, but I agree that it's really something to start to take in account. Yeah.
I'm pretty much interested about these managerial issues that are somehow related to the making of curb topology, since you don't produce map for yourself. As you say, okay, I can make a map and I can put it on the wall of my room and then look at it and see, okay, it's very nice. But most, if I'm not wrong, as you live with this practice, so you're basically working for clients of different nature. I mean, there are public clients, or maybe also private clients, authorities, whatever, different kind of investors in your practice. So I really wonder about what kind of I mean, which are the clients that are somehow in interest in your practice and in your outcomes? So this, I think this introduces very critical issues, at least, because I think this was crucial for Foucault, for instance. Foucault basically said that cartography was the device, that represented the power of the state power. So this is, I mean, he had in mind maps like this, you see, where the French Empire, you know, where it's a kind of a diagram where everything is kind of, represented in a geometric way, is kind of arranged in a very mathematical sense. So there is a kind of relationship between the managerial aspect of the state and the way, you know, the place is in the end arranged. But actually, other clients, like, I mean, what kind of clients do you think are ideal, by the way, for the practice of the curb topologist?
The ideal client? That's a client with a lot of money. That is really, really with a lot of money. Then we only need one client left and then we can do whatever. No, I think the perfect client, I think the clients up until now is, most of the times, and it started like that, it started with municipalities that are completely capable of making maps that you just mentioned, of imposing and of knowing from their mind, not taking in account the field where their maps should then be executed somehow, or where the plans need to be executed. But as said, our way of dealing with maps is the opposite. We can't map if you're not in the field. So we start really by observing and by being there. And also the map for us as map makers ends from the moment that we leave. So from the moment that the container gets on the truck again, that means that the drawing stops somehow. So there's very hard deadlines. And it's important, because otherwise you're again mapping from a distance and you don't have that interplay between inside, outside anymore. And that is where the map gets built for us, or the drawing gets built. So our client is mostly somebody who wants that perspective but doesn't know how to deal with it, and is very capable of making the other way, you know, making a plan and then imposing, but knows more and more that that imposing doesn't work anymore. As architects, we are afraid of the participation and the co-creation evenings. And it's to find a place there that cartopology gets in somehow, and not, and again, not having people yelling at an architect, but we as architects participate within the daily life instead of having everybody participating in a design process, because why would you study architecture then, right? Or any kind of design course. No, the daily life of that place, that is where the expertise of the inhabitants is, and that's where you need to find them and to take them serious, not as a designer, but as an inhabitant of a place. And that is where we take them, that's what we translate somehow on the map. And our ideal client is somebody who is really looking for that, but also very open-minded, that doesn't expect an answer, but that is very curious to have not one question, but multiple extra formulated questions that helps them looking differently. So in the beginning of our practice, we did it a little bit like you explained in the beginning. We were the whole day, the whole 3 months that we are on location, we were making the map. And then at the end, we were like, look, we didn't hang it on the wall, but further than that, there was, this is the result. Do you like it or not? And that didn't work. Because they were like, no, I don't want a map. I don't want to do any effort. I just want bullets that I can convince other elder men to participate or not. And the more we continued, the more also we got frustrated in the sense of, why am I actually drawing? What are we doing? What's why isn't it working? And now all the projects that we do, we involve very actively our client from the beginning. So actually the client, let's say the civil servant, sees much more unfinished maps than he sees the final one. If we deliver the final one, it's only to put in the local newspaper and that's it. He doesn't really look at it anymore. He doesn't need to look at it anymore because he had the whole process of map making and he was involved in the map making. So he was involved in looking differently. He was involved in becoming aware of that daily life. He was involved in becoming aware of those habits and routines and rituals of a certain place. And that is where you see that, where at the end you would think then, oh, they don't have to look at the map anymore. All of a sudden, the drawing, the map, becomes very active thing because they recognize things. They see how the process went. They see they can localize things on the map and they can actually work with it. So by not putting the map as an end result, but the process, the map as end result worked much better.
Actually, don't you think that cartopology has a certain political agency? Like, I mean, let's look at this very old, you know, kind of satirical map, this Ironies of Nationalism, 1870. Here you see that, I mean, what is represented is not the place, but it's a kind of an event, it's a kind of an ideology, idiosyncrasies and whatever, but it's not the place. So basically here mapping is used evidently for another agency that is not mapping the place, but it's to provide people with a certain ideological outcome. And then, I mean, these kind of maps that are more or less, you know, sons of the same father. But actually, what I want to say is that, I mean, didn't you think that the kind of power that you can open up with this practice of cartopology, you know, can really overextend the kind of service and, I mean, the kind of translation, because you often use this word to translate, you mean to become kind of, you know, the hand, the draws, but not really. I mean, it seems you want to go out of your, I mean, to kind of avoid your own ideological and political, you know, kind of ideas.
Of course, this is not the area or the territory. Of course, the map is not the territory, but maybe this is as much the land or the situation as the map is that you just shown with the border lines on it. Because also nation state borders, we don't perceive them in a way as they are mapped. So maybe this is as much or as less the territory as for example this map indeed.
I think they both are very, you can compare them in the sense that they are very one-directional and single layered in a way. They show one representation. And I think what our maps and what the Humboldt map also shows is that you need multiple layers in order to fully understand the place, or to maybe not fully, but to better understand the place. And I think that's also where we definitely never ever want to be or could be complete in a way. That's also why we never want to be objective, because that doesn't make sense when you make maps, especially when you make anthropological maps, where you are at a certain point, at a certain time, in a certain moment in our lives, doing research somewhere, which is all part of the map. So it is not at all objective, and luckily it isn't, because then it would become a very wrong, powerful document. But it is some sort of notation of two researchers living there, and that's how you have to perceive it, and that's also how you have to deal with it in further research. Now, this map is an official map of a border region within Europe. So Europe counts more than 100 of these types of regions, and these regions exist because they exist around the inner borders of Europe. In this case, between the Netherlands, Belgium, and Germany. And what is interesting is that those borders not in pandemic times, but in normal times, very easy to cross. So you don't have the hassle of do I have my ID with me kind of stress to cross them. They're very easy to cross. It's a luxury thing, I want to say. So it's not a real national border where somewhere else in the world it is the case. And what I really like about this kind of maps is that these regions exist because of their borders. If there wouldn't be a border, then there wouldn't be a border region, right? Although how they talk about their borders is to get rid of them, to make it easier to work on the other side of the border, to make it easier to travel, to shop, to whatever. And that's also how they depict their borders. They only have four different types of lines on this map. Although the border is the identity of that map, right? Of that region. It is the identity that's why that region exists. So why depicting it first so poorly and secondly so strictly or so rigidly? Mm. Because it's not because the administrative border is exactly on that point that that's where you will perceive the border. Maybe when I cross a border, I only perceive it when I start talking their language, for instance, or when I see that all of a sudden I don't have any croissant anymore in the bakery, but I have a donut, whatever, I don't know. So in that kind of things, that's where you get, that's where you realize, oh, I crossed the border and I have those cultures so close to me for the inhabitants of a border region. And in this project, which finishes the 1st of December, you're all invited to the Zoom meeting as well, what we try to do here is literally see the map as an instrument that we don't draw and we don't map, but that we help you to draw your map yourself. So the top part, to keep it short, the top part is all factual information about the border, and the under what you see, all the strips under it, are people that filled in their border experience while they were crossing it, while they were doing a border crossing act. And that helped us to have not only our perception or our experience, but to share it with others. And the thing is so all the strips can be reorganized, not according to author, but according to subject matters or topics that are important according to somebody who's reshuffling the map in a way. So even if you haven't participated in drawing the stripes, to make strips, to look at the map, you still have to reshuffle yourself. And what is interesting here is that drawing maps as research instruments is a constant balance between keeping it strict And for instance, asking everybody to draw with the exact pen so that we can combine them so that it stays also a beautiful map, let's say, an artistic document. And at the same time, giving enough freedom so that everybody can, I'm going to use the word again, appropriate the map and use it in their own practice, in their own border crossing experience in a way. And that's something that we're experiencing with a lot of these times, to see the map as an instrument that you can use almost as an exercise to perceive your environment differently.